Can put a human ear on the back of a mouse. Is this a good thing? If they can create a rabbit that glows in the dark.
Oh, yes.
Should we fear it? And if they can make a goat that produces spider silk in its milk.
It's extraordinary.
Is this going too far? Since time began, evolution has produced weird and wonderful creatures. Now man can do the same. Science has allowed us to unlock the secrets of life itself. So are we, as some believe, on the verge of a terrible nightmare, in a world gone mad? Or could genetic engineering be a force for good, to help create a world where nobody goes hungry?
Thank you very much.
Where our bodies regenerate. This is not tomorrow's world. It's happening now. If all the plants and animals that have been created by science were gathered together on one farm, then this is what it would look like. The farm is imaginary, but all the plants and creatures you're about to see are real. Welcome to our animal farm. We've placed two people on our farm to guide us around. Scientist Olivia Judson is a strong supporter of genetic engineering and wants to persuade you that it really can improve the world.
I'm a biologist. I spend my time learning about animals, plants, fungi, bacteria. I find genetic engineering amazing. It's a new frontier of science that has the possibility of transforming all of our lives. For me, genetic engineering isn't so much frightening as inspiring. It opens up a world of wonder.
Food journalist Giles Corran is a passionate advocate for organic farming. He finds what's being done in the name of science a real cause for concern.
As a food writer, I spend a lot of my time seeking out the best natural food that I can. Organically grown fruit and vegetables, free-range meat and eggs. And as far as I'm concerned, when it comes to feeding the planet, nature has made a pretty good job of it. So when I hear about the brave new world of genetic engineering and the Frankenfood that it produces, it strikes me as completely pointless. And to be honest, very scary.
Olivia Judson and Giles Corran are about to see some plants and animals that are truly beyond belief. Are these modern-day Frankenstein's monsters? Or could they transform our lives and the world for the better? For them and us, it's time to decide. Giles's tour around our farm begins in the cowsheds. He's going to meet some extraordinary creatures. The Schwarzeneggers of the cow world.
What kind of cow makes a noise like that? It sounds more like an elephant.
In the cowshed, the man in charge of the beef herd is Patrice Lobe.
He's a big fellow. Am I all right?
He's quite big, huh? He's 160 meters tall, yeah.
If I saw a man like that,
yeah.
But I wouldn't get this close to him, I don't think. I would think he was on steroids or something. He was a bodybuilder.
It is 100% natural, whereby, let's say, within so many generations, our breeders have taken the best of the best, or the more muscle of the more muscle. We moved from a normal, classical type of animal, and then we select that sort of animal based on the double muscle.
And when you say double muscle,
yeah.
Do you mean it has two of every muscle?
No.
Because it looks like it does.
Absolutely.
In almost,
it has exactly the same type of muscle than any other breed, except that, in terms of quantity, each of these muscles is by far more developed.
Right.
This Schwarzenegger cow is technically known as a Belgian Blue, and it's the product of selective breeding.
Selective breeding is the first stop on our tour of how man is using science to control nature. It's used by farmers to enhance desirable characteristics in their animals. In fact, selective breeding is all about managing sex. To create these Belgian blues, over 100 years, farmers have only allowed the cows and bulls with the greatest muscle mass to mate. And the result is a bull that weighs over a ton.
These things are massive. I'm amazed they can even stand up. And they're bred just to produce the most muscle possible. It's not a bull, it's a steak mountain.
You see, now this fellow looks a bit different. I mean, here you can really see the muscles. Is it healthy?
The animal, you mean?
Yeah.
Well, the animal is as healthy as another intensive producing animal.
Like bodybuilders oiling their pecs, these cows are shaved to show off their muscles.
What they try to do is to clip the animals in order to highlight all the muscle. You see?
Well, so you can see where all the meat is.
Exactly.
But even here, where they've sort of trimmed in there.
Yeah, to highlight that muscle, yeah, which has got a high value. You see?
And these are all going to be lean cuts, and they're all for quick cooking, are they?
Yeah, that's right.
Because when you look at this, you can't help thinking of lunch, you know? So this is about the most technological that meat can get.
Not the most technological. In terms of technology, we talk about selection, natural selection, having achieved that.
He may call it natural selection, but it doesn't look very natural to me. I mean, just look at the size of that arse.
There is a gene which regulates the growth of muscles in cattle. These cows have been selectively bred from animals that contain a copy of this gene that doesn't work. Without the gene, the muscles grow far larger than normal.
So, how do these monsters mate? Well, not surprisingly, sex has been replaced by technology in the form of artificial insemination, a process in which man quite literally takes a hand.
Gosh, he's got quite a dong, hasn't he? He is basically a sperm machine.
He is a sperm machine, absolutely.
It's very early in the morning for...
I understand.
The semen is now collected, it's in the artificial vagina, and from there we will process the semen in order to be able to process artificial insemination on the cow.
So precise is the technology involved, they can analyse the semen sperm by sperm to choose the ones they want.
So this is... this is testing the sperm count?
That's a sperm analyzer. It's now checking, let's say, the quality of the sperm we have been collecting this morning. Green is good because you see that they are very, very mobile and they are looking forward to move towards the eggs.
And these are not especially muscly sperm?
Don't you find that they are very muscled?
Well, they look impressive to me, but I've never seen any other bull sperm.
No. Visually, no. You won't see any difference. There is no way to find any difference between the bovine, the equine, and the other species, no.
Right.
Well, I found the whole experience deeply disturbing. They call it natural selection, but it's been designed by men to exploit animals for their own ends. You saw that animal, the huge packs of muscle, the kind of quadruple arses they've got. All that money, all that science, all that energy, it just struck me as pointless and soul-destroying, rather as I imagine the wider genetic modification project probably is.
Whilst to Giles, this seems shocking and unnatural. Scientist Olivia Judson has a very different view of what's natural in the first place.
It's always fascinated me that what we think of as natural is often anything but. Take this farmhouse treasure trove, the classic image of nature's bounty. But nothing on this table is simply the product of natural evolution. We've been genetically manipulating fruit and vegetables for thousands of years. Take the carrot. Crisp, juicy, orange. But until about 300 years ago, carrots usually looked like this. White. The Dutch selectively bred orange carrots as a tribute to their royal family,
the House of Orange. The pink grapefruit we eat are all clones of one original mutant grapefruit.
We've forgotten that the potato was originally poisonous. The wheat was once just a scrawny, wild grass. Farmers have been interfering with nature for thousands of years.
And on our farm, they are still at it. Next, Olivia is about to meet a new kind of chicken, which may come as a bit of a surprise.